Girls first. 14, 19, 12.
Hundreds of dancers are called, but only a few can be chosen in a chorus line. The Broadway musical is one of the four new movies we'll be reviewing this week on At the Movies, the movie review program. I'm Roger Ebert, film critic of the Chicago Sun-Times.
And I'm Gene Siskel, film critic of the Chicago Tribune. In addition to a chorus line, we'll also be reviewing the eagerly awaited sequel to the adventure film Romancing the Stone. This one's called The Jewel of the Nile. And once again, it stars Michael Douglas, Kathleen Turner, and Danny DeVito. And we'll also look at a fascinating British film that follows the same youngsters from age 7 to 14 to 21 to 28. And it sees how they've all turned out. The results are remarkable. But first, Roger begins with John Voight's latest role in a film called Runaway Train.
I have to start out by saying that Runaway Train is quite simply one of the best adventure movies I've ever seen, a combination of action and suspense and desperate characters that never stop surprising me. The movie stars John Voight as a hardened convict in an Alaska prison. For the last 3 years, his cell door has been welded shut. But now he's escaped, taking another convict, played by Eric Roberts, along with him. They get on board a train, but the engineer dies of heart failure, and it turns into a runaway. Here they are talking about their prospects in the outside world.
I'll tell you what you're going to do. You're going to get a job. That's what you're going to do. You're going to get a little job, some job a convict can get, like scraping off trays in the cafeteria or cleaning out toilets. And you're going to hold on to that job like gold, because it is gold. Let me tell you, Jack, that is gold. You listen to me! And when that man walks in at the end of the day, and he comes to see how you've done, you ain't gonna look in his eyes. You're gonna look at the floor. Because you don't want to see that fear in his eyes when you jump up and grab his face and slam him to the floor and make him scream and cry for his life. So you look right at the floor, Jack. Pay attention to what I'm saying. And then he's gonna look around the room, see how you've done. He's gonna say, oh, you missed a little spot over there. Gee, you didn't get this one here. What about this little bitty spot? And you're going to suck all that pain inside you. And you're going to clean that spot. And you're going to clean that spot. Until you get that shining clean. And on Friday, you pick up your paycheck. And if you could do that, if you could do that, you could be president of Chase Manhattan Corporations. If you could do that.
That's a great speech. It turns out they're not the only two people on the runaway train. Rebecca De Mornay plays a crew member who's also powerless to stop the train.
What did you say?
No brakes, no brakes.
That's mean.
That's truth. Now make it now. Go for it.
Yeah, come back.
Go for it, sucker, come on.
I tell what.
There are some great stunts in this movie, and a real sensation of movement as that enormous train hurtles at 90 miles an hour, totally out of control down the track. Most of the movie consists of cutaways between that train and the railroad dispatchers who are desperately trying to get everything out of its way. But if that were all the movie was about, it'd be exciting, but it would also be pretty predictable. The very best thing about Runaway Train is the way the characters of those convicts, played by John Voight and Eric Roberts, are developed as that train races through Alaska. This is John Voight's best performance in a long time, and by the end of the film, he had me absolutely fascinated about whether he would choose life or death. Runaway Train is a great film, and I just hope it doesn't get overlooked in the avalanche of so many of the other holiday pictures.
Well, Roger, I liked what John Voight did in the film, and I liked the first scene that we saw very, very much. It's a beautiful speech. I think it's at the core of the film. And if I think the film had been more on that tone, I think it would have been much better. I find there are four main characters in this film. We saw three of them, De Mornay and the two convicts, and the fourth character is really the train. And I'll tell you, the train, they used so much of it, it really bored me.
Really?
I got bored seeing the train. They cut so much of the train. All that dispatcher stuff, it was just phony compared to the realism of Voight's performance. Mm-hmm. Eric Roberts, I thought, overacted. You complained about him overacting in the last film that he did. I think he really went over the top this time. And Rebecca De Mornay's character, I think they threw her in just to have a woman in there. I don't think she has any place in this film. So really, all that I like about it is John Hoyt.
Well, I think you probably found things that may be some of the weak points, although I don't agree there's too much of the train. The train is fascinating. The way it's photographed is fascinating. What I like is the fact that the director, Andrei Konchalovsky, has a real idea about these characters. The action in this film...
Not about the woman.
His ideas... Why should it be about the woman? There are a dozen people in the movie he doesn't have ideas about.
Okay.
He has ideas about these two men.
Mm-hmm.
And the way that they're expressed through this conflict and through this crisis that they're in is very important. Now, so the woman, she's there not to have a character of her own, but to demonstrate the way that these men absolutely have no way at all of understanding that she is a woman or how to relate to her because of their many dehumanizing years in the prison.
Okay, well, that's thank you for the explanation.
Well, but, guess you needed it.
Yeah, I did need it because I didn't see that. Well,
okay. You're welcome.
But I'm telling you, what about Eric Roberts? Do you like his performance?
I liked it better in this movie than I've liked him in anything in a long time, since Star 80, in fact, because his posturing seemed to be part of the personality he had as a prisoner.
I think he went. I think he was a prisoner who had gone to a lot of acting classes, if you want to know my opinion. Coming up next at the movies, there's more real-life adventure in store for romance writer Kathleen Turner in Jewel of the Nile.
Having no choice is no fun. That's why at Wendy's, every hamburger isn't dressed the same. Choose fresh tomato, fresh lettuce, fresh onions, cheese, bacon, and more. Choose fresh. Choose Wendy's. Maytag. Still washing. Still drying. Still cooking. Still cleaning. Still innovating.
And still lonely.
Maytag. The dependability people.
One of the big surprise hits from 1984 was Romancing the Stone. I still think it's a horrible title, but it was a funny, charming, and rousing good film featuring two rascal jewel thieves. Michael Douglas and Danny DeVito teamed up with a meek romance writer played to perfection by Kathleen Turner. She turns into a tiger at the end. The film was an original. Now they tried to copy it with a sequel, and I think they failed. It's the same cast, except this time Danny DeVito has many more barnyard dirty remarks, and it gets real boring quickly. Once again, the film puts the romantically involved Michael Douglas and Kathleen Turner into a dangerous situation, this time in the Arab desert, with her trying to protect a holy man.
What is it with you? I mean, everything's always got to be your way, and it's just like the damn boat.
What do you mean, my way? It wasn't my idea to spend 6 months on your boat.
Oh,
no,
it made good. I enjoyed.
Okay, let me tell you what I put up with. We're moored off the Canary Islands, right? Midnight, sound asleep. Three crazy Joan Wilder fans decide they want the anchor of the Angeline for a souvenir. We were drifting for days.
Stop.
And what about the other time?
I'm sorry. It stands for just John.
Remember the Costa del Sol, Duck?
Oh, come on.
He's got to meet me at the governor's for a formal dinner. And you show up with the entire Italian national basketball team.
Hey, they were hungry.
Oh, this is exactly what I'm talking about. I just wish sometimes you could think about me.
Oh, and I suppose you were thinking all about me when you took off with Omar, huh? Did I tell you he blew up my boat?
Our boat?
Oh, now it's our boat.
It's good. Good debate. It's equal, no winners. Just, John, we must hurry.
Oh, no, wait, what do you mean he blew up our boat?
Just tell me one thing. Why are you risking your life for this guy?
I made a commitment. I can't break it.
I didn't think it was such a good debate. Unfortunately, the film shows its real desperation with the Raiders of the Lost Ark style, rat pit, snake pit scene, played too much for laughs. We don't take the film seriously anymore at this point.
You wouldn't happen to have a knife, would you?
I'm not even wearing underwear.
Great.
We were good together, weren't we, Joan Wilder?
The best.
And we're gonna make it.
Yeah.
Oh, God, I love you, lady.
You're not just saying that because this is it, are you?
never seen it because I'm not afraid to say it anymore.
I like it when it's just the two of them talking. The story they're in, though, bores me to pieces. We know how that scene is going to turn out, and that's the problem with the sequel based on the original that depended so much on surprise and character evolution. Here's the key. In Jewel of the Nile, all the characters are set. They don't change, and they run and are run through a dumb story. And maybe here's one more thought. All of the terrorist activities in the world going on with the Arab world, maybe that had something to do with my displeasure with this film. Because frankly, I didn't care as they run through the Arab world whether these film's heroes saved anyone.
Maybe it's because we've seen so many burnouses on the television.
It's hard to charge that against the film.
But on the other hand, Avner Eisenberg, who plays the holy man there, is fabulous in this film. I thought he was so funny in the deadpan way that he kind of found that line between being a holy man and being kind of a funny straight man. And incidentally, I found a lot of other things good in this film. You put down that rat pit scene. You thought it was from Raiders of the Lost Ark. I thought it was funny in the same way that Raiders and Romancing the Stone were funny. I thought the whole movie was lighthearted and entertaining.
Didn't you think that they ran through the desert just too much, the whole middle of the film? That, I thought, was so weak. I wanted more of the two of them. Once I get to know characters in an original, then I want to hone in on the characters.
I don't know what you thought you wanted from this movie in the first place. At one point, you were saying you didn't take the movie seriously after such and such a point.
Right.
I didn't take the movie seriously from the beginning.
No.
It's a comedy. It's a romance.
It's not
supposed to be taken seriously. Whether you like the two of them together or not, it's not really just a love story about two people. It's supposed to be, to some degree, an action parody.
Yeah, well, I prefer at this point the two of them together more than the parody, because the parody didn't work because they were put in a boring place.
Mm-hmm.
How's that for an answer?
It's an answer, all right. Next is the movie, the long-running hit Broadway musical, A Chorus Line, comes to the screen at last. The longest-running stage musical in history tells the story of the preparations for a Broadway musical. Of course, the name of the play is A Chorus Line, and after a nearly 11-year run all over the world, the musical has finally become a movie, and a good movie, too. There are no real stars in the film. It's an ensemble piece, but the central character is the choreographer, played by Michael Douglas. He's a long way from the Nile, but just as good in this nervous, chain-smoking role as he was as a swashbuckler, at least as I thought he was. Here he is, Michael Douglas, early on the day when he'll select a chorus line from the dozens of hopeful applicants.
I want it strong. Make it sharp. Take it on the downbeat. Ready, and five, six, seven, eight.
Douglas wants his performers to act as well as dance, and so he asks them to talk about themselves. That leads to Charles McGowan's big number, I Can Do That.
What made you start dancing?
Because of my sister. She was a girl. So my mom decided she's the one to get all the dancing lessons. So every Saturday, my mother would take her. And once in a while, she'd take me along.
How old were you?
4, 5. I'd sit there all eager, and I'm watching Cisco pit-a-pat. Said, I can do that. I can do that. Knew every step right off the bat. Said, I can do that. I can do that. One morning, Sis won't go to dance class. I grabbed her shoes and tights and but my foot's too small, so I stood with extra socks. Run 7 blocks in nothing flat. I can do that. That I can do. Give a man some room.
Feeling of classic Donald O'Connor there.
Mm-hmm.
The Chorus Line was directed by Richard Attenborough. His last film was Gandhi, and you'd think that no two films could possibly be more different, yet in both stories, Attenborough shows a real gift for combining spectacular visuals with a real feeling for the people the story is about. By the end of that long day of auditioning for the Chorus Line, we know a lot about dancers, a lot about the theater, and a lot about the particular people who are up there on the stage. This is an intelligent, ambitious movie, and yet, the bottom line is that it works as a musical.
Well, it's such a brilliant concept on stage. I mean, that I think it would be almost impossible to screw this up entirely. Mm-hmm. I think Attenborough does make one mistake, and that is he tries to, as they always say, you know, open up the play. And this film, I don't think, works when it does that, which is a backstage love story between Michael Douglas, the choreographer, who I think way overacts. I mean, he's really like, he might as well have a bullwhip.
You know a lot of choreographers who don't have bullwhips?
I don't know any choreographers, and I don't know any choreographers that have bullwhips.
I have a feeling that he was extremely convincing as a guy who was actually in command of this of this turf.
Let me make my point, though. The relationship between the two of them, Douglas and his girlfriend, is handled completely different in the movie than in the play. We see a backstage and flashback. I think none of that works. What's great is just what we saw there at the end and why I like the movie, and that is when we see the individuals do their thing, tell their story. You could have almost filmed this play straight, really straight, without any additions, and I think it would be even better.
Yeah, but of course, what you're doing is the old compare and contrast kind of senior and college.
Well, this is
sort
a classic.
It's not, well, it may be a classic, but nevertheless, 9 out of 10 people who see this movie will not have seen the play even so.
I don't know about
especially
that.
Especially by the time it gets on television.
Gene,
this will be a new experience, and as the movie that Attenborough makes, and his responsibility is to his movie, not to the play, he has made a good movie. Opening it up, people who haven't seen the play aren't going to think it was opened up. They're just going to think that, gee, here's the
thing. I'm telling you this.
It doesn't take place on the stage.
Okay, and I'm going to tell you that the flashbacks, then, as flashbacks, are boring and predictable. How's that?
Okay,
he does overplay.
Now you're doing better
fine.
Now. That's
I'll
true,
do a little bit better. He overplays and she overplays, and if it had been just on stage, I know it would be much better. And I still like the movie.
Okay, thank you very much. 2 thumbs up, then?
Yeah, but yours is a little higher.
A lot of us didn't smile a lot while we were putting the thumbs up. Coming up next, would you like to see... Look at him.
I'm angry.
He looks a little unhappy. Would you like to see what you were like at age 7 and 14? These English students were part of such an experiment.
What do you think about girlfriends at your age?
And
what do you think?
Well, I've got one, but I don't think much of her.
I've often declared myself to be a big fan of documentary films because they so often contain the drama that fiction films go begging to create. And that's certainly the case with the remarkable English documentary 28 Up, in which director Michael Apted has followed the dreams and realities of a group of vastly different British school children from the age of 7 to more interviews with them at age 14, to still more interviews at age 21, and then again at 28. This was done for British television, and it's now being shown as a feature film. And by and large, the film shows that when you look at all the kids over all the years, that the child really is the seed of the man or the woman. Here's one of the test cases. 3 very upper-class boys, first at 14, then 21.
What's the point of the program? It's the point of the program is to reach a comparison. I don't think it is.
We're not necessary typical example.
I think that's what people seeing the program might think.
Yes,
falsely.
I mean, they tend to typecast us.
So everything we say, they'll think, oh, that's a typical result of the public school system.
Yes.
I mean, do you think there's any truth in the ideas behind the program, that certain people have more options than others?
Certainly true that more people know they have more options or imagine they have. I think in practical terms, the difference in numerical number of options isn't that great.
But the mere knowledge creates an option in itself.
Yeah.
So I think we
That's
do have more options. And it is undesirable, but it's very difficult to correct.
I don't think it is undesirable at all. I think what's undesirable is people who have had options, they make advantage of them, take best advantage of them.
Now the most disturbing yet fascinating character of the whole test group, Neil, a little sour as a child, a drifter now at age 28.
When I get married, I don't want to have any children because they are always doing naughty things and making the whole house untidy.
I always told myself that I would never have children.
Why?
Because children inherit something from their parents, and even if my wife were the most high-spirited and ordinary and normal of people, the child would still stand a very fair chance of being not totally full of happiness because of what he or she Will have inherited from me.
This is, that character is as riveting as any you'll see in any film this year, that's for sure. He's a real person. The seeds of his loneliness were in his young face. I think you could see, even though he was smiling, he was talking about not wanting to have children because they mess up their houses. Who talks like that? And so we find out that he did have a bad time at home as a youth. But this movie is more than just a research paper into human growth. It's funny and entertaining and warm. And above all, this is the real proof it's so good, it makes you wish you had similar films of yourself. Boy, I wish I did. I love 28 Up.
I don't have similar films of myself from the ages of 7 and 14, but as I was watching this movie and thinking about it later, films in my own memory began to play of what I was like then. And I've got to admit, if you could have found little Roger at the age of 7,
yes.
I'm afraid if I could have looked at myself then from the outside, I would have said, it's pretty much, the die is pretty much cast. That's the kind of guy you're going to be at 14, 21, 28, 35, and so forth. I wonder if the same thing was true of little Gene.
Absolutely. There's no question that I feel, first of all, my internal age now, I think I'm 39. I think I'm really about 19.
Yeah.
I think that's true for a lot of people. We're still in college and all that. But I also, psychologically, the same themes. It was fascinating to see it in other people. Terrific idea for a film.
To see a movie like that makes you reevaluate everybody you know and what you think about them and realize that what I think of as you may have actually just been in the cards.
Yeah.
Now let's take another look at the movies we reviewed this week. We had a split decision for Runaway Train, although we both liked the great John Voight performance. I thought it was a great adventure movie. We split on Jewel of the Nile. Gene thought it wasn't as good as romancing the film, but I thought it was a good entertainment. We also both liked The Chorus Line, Richard Attenborough's backstage musical about life as a Broadway dancer. And finally, two more thumbs up for the unusual documentary, 28 Up, which checked in on the same people every 7 years on their journey through life. So actually, of the ones I liked the most, probably 28 Up was the one that made me think the most, although I liked all the movies.
28 Up is the best one for me, and then I would probably pick Chorus Line next. Mm-hmm. Well, not probably. I mean, that's the only other one I did like.
Okay, well, then in that case, I guess you're right.
Very simple. 28 Chorus Line. Now, that's it for this week. Next time, we'll be back with reviews of still more big holiday movies, including Robert Redford and Meryl Streep in Out of Africa, the story of a European writer in Kenya in the early part of the century. And we'll also review Enemy Mine, a science fiction film starring Louis Gossett and Dennis Quaid, one human, one an alien. And until then, we'll see you at the movies.